is a burning thing, and it makes a fiery ring. Bound by wild desire, I fell into a ring of fire. I fell into a burning ring of fire. I went down, 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 and the flames went higher. And it burns, 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 the ring of fire, the ring of fire. I fell into a burning ring of fire. I went down, 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 and the flames went higher. And it burns, 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 the ring of fire, the ring of fire. The taste of love is sweet when hearts like ours.
We're here with the Franklin Flyer, Steve Barnett, driver of the number 89 late model. Steve, thanks for having us. I grew up watching you race. You know, we track every week, Brownstown, and they always announced you as the Franklin Flyer. We don't hear that much anymore. How did that come about?
Well, first off, I'm glad you guys are here. And, you know, you growing up watching me, there's probably been a lot of kids grow up watching me because younger than you, and now they're old guys. So, but anyway, the Franklin Flyer, when I was in high school, I was a high hurdler, and I won a track meet, and they showed me going over one of the high hurdles, and they had the Franklin Flyer in there, and that just kind of stuck with friends and stuff from around Franklin here.
Okay, that's cool. And you mentioned, you know, Franklin. Tell us a little bit about your involvement in the Franklin community.
To start with, Franklin's got a real good community. For the people that don't know, we're about 25,000 people. And after I had my bad wreck at Brownstown, three years back, when I rode my car, my wife said it knocked some sense into me, or knocked some sense out of me. I don't know which. But anyway, there was a seat open on the Franklin City Council, and I ran for that position. So I'm on the Franklin City Council, and actually the council president this year. And also on the Board of Works, and do a lot of fundraising, charity work in our community, and exalt a ruler at what you call the Franklin Elks Lodge, number 1818, and we do a lot of stuff.
Okay, and I was looking through some of your stats. You got your start in racing in 1975, I believe. Tell us a little bit about, you know, why you decided to go racing.
Well, I was always brought up around it. My dad had race cars, and I worked on the cars probably in the late 60s on up, and he had some good drivers, like start out with like John Warner and Russ Petro, Roger Absher, Paul Crockett, and I always worked on my dad's cars, and he got just one day I decided I was going to try to do the driving part of it. I was tired of working on them all the time. All right. And my dad didn't let me just drive his car. I had to go buy my own car and work the hard way. And after a year of doing it on my own, he decided to go sell all the junk you got, and we'll try to go racing.
Okay, that's cool. So, you know, you've been racing a number of years now. If there's one accomplishment that sticks out in your mind the most, that you're the most proud of, which one would it be?
Well, you know, racing a whole lot of years like I have, I can't think of just one great accomplishment. I guess winning 6 Northern All-Star Championships, that's pretty cool. Winning 4 Brownstown Championships, that's pretty cool. I don't know, there's just won the Kentucky Classic. That was a big race back in the days. Been in more Jackson 100s than anybody. Run 2nd in the Dream in 97. There's just been a lot of good memories. So I can't just pick out one. Right. There's a lot of good things that – you know, you're only as good as your last race. So.
That's right.
So we're still looking to move on.
Okay, yeah. And, you know, we're talking about your accomplishments. Obviously, you've raced at a ton of different racetracks. If you had to pick one that would be your favorite track, which one would it be?
Well, you know, you always have to go back probably to your home track where you grew up. And Brownstown, Indiana, it was always my favorite. Also, although I do like I liked Hagerstown, Maryland. Hagerstown was like a big Brownstown to me. And there's that Eldor course, that's a good track. And mm-hmm. there's just so many Twin Cities here in Indiana. That's a good track. There's just a bunch of good tracks all over the country. Zanesville, Ohio, I've been to. West Virginia Motor Speedway.
Right.
Can't really pick one. Brownstown's probably the favorite.
Okay. Brownstown being your favorite track, obviously, you know, it's evolved quite a bit in the past, you know, several years. And take us through what, you know, the changes you've seen and you know, over the years at Brownstown.
Well, are you talking about the track or are you talking about the cars?
Both. Well, whatever you want to talk about.
Well, Brownstown was always known as a dry slick racetrack, mm-hmm. and that's what I prefer. I'm a dry slick guy. Haven't been too favorable of the track in the last couple of years, the way it's plowed up and all that stuff. Yep. At halftime, I'm not for all that. But as far as the cars go, that's pretty interesting because starting back in late 60s, working on cars and then helping my, you know, then driving in 75, my first late model was a Chevelle, and that's what street stockers are now. So it was a Chevelle, and then we kind of got into – it was like a plastic body cars, and C.J. Rayburn brought in the tube frame cars, so we got to do that. And then we got into the wedge days, and that was mm-hmm. that was awesome. That was a good deal. One of the accomplishments there that I remember, now that we bring that up, the wedge cars, outrun a sprint car in a match race in a wedge
really?
Car.
That's cool.
Yeah, that was at Lincoln Park Speedway. Then we went to the small UMP body styles, and now where we're at today. So mm-hmm. there's been a lot of evolution through the race cars, and I got to be a part of all of it.
That's cool. You know, not a lot of people can say that. And you know, I guess I should have asked earlier if there's one win out there that you find the most prestigious, or that you'd like to have your name on the trophy. Which one would it be?
Well, I'd have to say the Jackson 100. I finished second in it three times, and, you know, that's kind of tough to take. But one time I finished second, my dad's car actually won it, and it was Petro. So
okay.
So that's not too bad a deal, I guess. Of course, you know, you always got the big marquee race like the World 100 mm-hmm. and the Dream and that sort of thing. But Jackson 100's a local favorite for me.
Okay. And, you know, here at In the Fast Lane, we're trying to really promote family and kids and getting them back involved in racing, because I think, you know, in the past few years it's kind of fell off, the kids and, you know, the family come to the races. What's something you think that we could do, you know, promoters and everybody for that matter, that would get kids and families back involved?
Well, that's good that you say that, because my kids grew up at the racetrack. I had two daughters, they went with me all the time. And I think what has happened is the promoters is went away from the local every Saturday night racing.
Right.
And, you know, they just want to promote the big races. And quite frankly, every average family can't afford to go to a big race with their family. So if you got back to more of the Saturday night racing, make it affordable where the kids can go with the family again, that would be that's why it fell off. I mean, promoters, some promoters, they cry they can't get the crowd. But if you don't race every Saturday night.
That's right.
They're going to go away. They're going to find something else to do. And that's kind of what's happened, especially around the Brownstown area, not racing mm-hmm. every Saturday night. That's really hurt.
Yeah, you know, there's a lot of people, you know, have told us the same thing. I know this year, you know, there's going to be more opportunities racing-wise. I think Brownstown's planning on racing a lot more, and obviously Twin Cities are going to race a lot more. Tell us a little bit about your 2013 plans and what you plan on doing.
Well, I plan on racing every Saturday night, and the guys at Twin City, they said they're going to be open every Saturday night. There's no ifs, ands, and buts about it, and I want to go race where they're going to be open. If they're not open, I can't be there.
Right.
So I'm probably looking to go to Twin Cities and race quite a bit. Of course, I'll go to Brownstown when I get the opportunity, because that is my favorite track. But I'm gearing up to go to Brownstown go to North Vernon. And it's kind of funny you bring it up, because I just had a conversation with C.J. Rayburn this morning. Was talking mm-hmm. on the phone, and he's got a new car that he's working on, and we might hook up this year. C.J.'s always been good to me over the years racing. I've kind of mm-hmm. went, you know, a few different directions every now and then, but C.J. lives 3 miles from me. His driveway is 3 miles from my driveway, and we kind of I guess I kind of growed up being a C.J. Rayburn fan and driving his cars and and working with him. So we might get back to that this year. We're talking about it right now.
Okay. You know, all this racing obviously takes a lot of help from, you know, crew and stuff like that. Who goes to the track with you each week and helps make it possible for you?
Well, I'll tell you what, I've been very fortunate. I got one gentleman, his name is Brad Hale, and Brad he's been helping me probably 20 years, he knows my style and I know his style, so we work pretty good together. So I'd have to say Brad's been the most steady help I've ever had. And then you get, then a boy named Justin Taylor, he goes with me. He's pretty good help. So we got good help around the shop during the week. I don't have time to do a whole lot of the work on the car. A guy named Clint Gant, he works on the bodies, and Randy Million kind of helps with keeping the shop clean, keeping the cars clean, and helping Clint keep up on the cars also.
Okay. And, you know, you can't see it on camera right now, but Tony Stewart's modified sitting over in front of us. Tell us a little bit about Tony's involvement in your racing career.
The way I got started with Tony involved in me, I met him through a mutual friend, Glenn Nibel, Tony and I just known each other for a lot of years, and I'm fortunate enough that he has helped with sponsorship with, along with him and JD Byrider. Tony kind of put that all together for us, and the modified we keep and take care of that, and my pit crew guys, whenever Tony goes and races his modified, they'll also help with that, sometimes Tony runs our late model local shows whenever we can, but it's been a good experience. And I don't know, I think we've probably been together close to 15 years now as far as the sponsorship goes. But we have a lot of fun when Tony gets to go race with us.
Oh, I bet.
Yeah, it happens two or three times a year, and we look forward to it when that time arrives.
Oh, definitely. You know, other than Tony, I know you got a lot of sponsors you'd like to thank. Who have you got this year?
Okay, we're looking at one of our sponsors here is the JD Byrider Car Sales. They're a nationwide buy here, pay here car lot that does really a good job. And they have been with me, I think we're working on about 15 years with JD Byrider. Really glad to have them on board. Then up here on the hood, we got our Billy Tranter builds our race motors, and he's kind of my best kept secret. I really don't want to get Billy out there because he gets too busy, but he does really a good job with my motors. And if you notice, I don't have motor problems because Bill Tranter, and he's also a local guy. I grew up with him, and just glad to have him working on our motor stuff. And then, of course, we got the Steve Barnett Racing. That's my wife's sponsorship. It should have Jeannie Barnett, but she lets me know that she actually owns the stuff, not me, but she lets me put my name there. And then down below, GB Graphics does all of our graphics works. That's my brother, and he's just across the lot here. He takes care of all the graphics on the car and does a really good job, and glad to have him on board. Then back here at the back, we got Outlaw Fabrications. That's Joe Godsey. I think everybody knows Joe. Joe and I kind of teamed up a couple years ago, 3 years ago, we stay pretty close and trade information and help each other around the racetrack and in the shop. Joe comes up and helps me sometimes. And likewise, if he needs some help, I can do what I can do to help him. Of course, we got Tony Stewart Racing. We've talked about him a little bit. Tony and his group, they're always there with a helping hand and want to help with the local stuff. If I need something, he's here for me. So appreciate that one. And we got this is actually another thing of my wife's that she puts on here, taking care of business in a flash. And I don't know if people know, but that was Elvis Presley's motto. So that come from Elvis, and my wife is a big Elvis fan. Okay, right here we got the Professional Edge Lawn Care. A local gentleman by the name of Seth Brown, he's in the lawn care business here in Franklin, and we do a lot of parades and have the cars sitting around here in town, and he does a good job and helps out with taking care of the grounds whenever I don't have time to do that. So if you're around here local, need to call Professional Edge. They do a good job. And up here we have this one more time for all the old times. And everybody asks me what's that about. I don't know. I've had that on there about 5 years, thinking it's going to be my last year, but it seems like we end up trying one more year. So we're going to do it again this year, one more time for all the old times.
Well, Steve, you know, thanks for having us. You know, wish you the best of luck this year. But is there something you forgot to tell everybody?
Or don't tell me you're trying to get me to thank my wife.
Well,
yeah, I guess I better thank my wife. Yep. But there is kind of an inside joke there that I need to tell. One time I was at a Northern All-Star banquet, and I won $10,000 for winning the championship. And everybody was, you know, thanking their wife and all this. So when I got up, when it come time to thank the wife, I said, I don't understand why the racers are thanking their wife. She ought to be thanking me for the money that I just won. So, yep. But no, I got to thank my wife. She stuck with me over all these years. Racing's pretty tough. I mean, it's hard on family lives, and it's really hard. If you're a true racer, you're a true racer, and you live, eat, sleep, and drink racing. And I've did that for several years. So yeah, she's been there. So thanks for that.
Okay, well, Steve, again, thanks for having us. Thanks for your time, and you know, hopefully, we get to see you in Victory Lane this year.
We hope to be there.
Thanks. Thank you. And Steve, we're doing something a little different here. We got a couple Facebook questions for you. Some of the fans that suggested we interview you. The first one is Spencer Watson. He wants to know about your steamroller and what involvement it has in your racing program.
Wow, that has to be somebody in the know. that's kind of funny because you know how late models, they get sheet metal banged up, and instead of just taking it off and beating it out with a hammer, we used to lay it out here on the driveway and take a roller and actually flatten it out and then put it back in the brake and re-brake it and put it on the car. I was so conservative, I wasn't going to go buy a new body just for a few wrinkles.
Right. Okay. The next question is Travis Humphrey. He just wants to know what you think about the cherry pickers.
Oh, man, that's a great group. And that's what you need at the racetracks. You need people like the cherry pickers there. If they're for you or against you, it doesn't make any difference.
They're watching you.
Oh, yeah. That's fun. That's a fun group to try to win over. Let's put it that way.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you guys, you know, we interview a lot of people. If there's somebody else, you know, you see we're going to be interviewing, you got a question, just, you know, get with us on Facebook and we'll get it in there for you.
I'm Steve Barnett, and you've been watching In the Fast Lane Productions, Lights, Camera, Dirt Sling in Action.